Me not stupid. Grimlock, smartest Dinobot of all.
Unfortunately, that's probably true. I just wish all the Dinobots had more sophisticated brains.
Brains? Grimlock know how to bash brains. Maybe bash yours.
I programmed into the analyzer has been processed. It is just as I suspected. Someone fed anti-electrons into the generator's power circuit.
Anti-electrons? Of course! Why didn't I think of that?
Perhaps because your mental abilities are so limited.
I'd like to start off by saying what a huge honor it is to be in your presence, digital or otherwise, Mr. Berger.
No worries. What part of St. Louis?
Ripcord and St. Louis County unincorporated, and so yeah. I'm on the edge there. I'm
very familiar, near the old Schneidhorst. Still some of the best German food anywhere, as is any German restaurant in St. Louis.
Well, they did have really big French fries.
There you go.
And bison burgers.
Yeah. Bison burgers and bratwurst, I still go most of the time I come back.
They made a lot of changes to that part, although the name kind of escapes me right now. I think it starts with an F.
It was town and country, kind of. It's all become Gold Coast.
The way they've changed it so much, I find it kind of depressing. I mean, I've lived here my entire life.
I like the St. Louis U Corridor. I like all that stuff off Grand. I think the city is wide awake.
Oh, before I forget, my dad wanted me to show you something. Here.
You remember the park more, right?
Of course.
Well,
I liked it. I liked everything but the chick burger.
Well, he wanted me to show you something that he got from it after they tore it down. Let me take the...
Fantastic!
Yeah.
That's the color. That's it. Very, very nice memento.
Yeah.
Long live the Parkmore, but it's not alive.
Well, you know, the same could be said for Mel Blanc, but I mean, he's still alive in all of us.
That's true. Jetson!
So, you know, I interviewed your fellow Autobot, Decepticon, and G.I. Joe, Michael Bell, right?
Yeah, you mentioned that. We're great pals.
Not even a year ago, or even a few months ago, would I ever dreamed that I would have gotten the chance to interview him, let alone Cutter, Ripcord, Grimlock,
and Agent K.
There you go.
Well, talking about Agent K, that makes me want to bring up something. I did a terrible wrong in contacting you the way that I did. I want to apologize right here and now for it.
You know what? It's all good. It happened, and you apologized, and I appreciate it. And it's just the wrong avenue to approach. So don't do it with anybody else. They might not be quite as nice.
Yeah, the irony there is, I actually called the guy who played Agent K before you did, Ed O. Ross, and I definitely rubbed him the wrong way, and I'm sorry for that too.
That's the lesson learned there. See, I'm the family archivist.
And when names came up, I used whitepages.com to try to find them and contact them out of the woodwork, and I'm pretty sure it surprised them too. And with that,
that's brave. Sure.
It's brave, but Icarus lost his wings when he got to the sun 5 trillion light years away from Earth.
They melted. Too close to the sun.
Yeah.
Okay, so to give a lay of the land here, I've got this Zoom interview recording, and I've got a backup recording on my phone. It's all going to be on YouTube, and also...
I wanted to have my cousin who runs Pumpernickels call in and ask you a question.
I've had breakfast there every time I'm in St. Louis. I have relatives in Kraven.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and Pumpernickels is phenomenal. Phenomenal.
I love their upside-down cupcakes.
There you go.
Yeah, so, I told him once I got to question 7, I'd give him a call, and he'd ask it in my place.
And he and I are interested in the same stuff. It's like we're twins, even though we're not even first cousins. We're like second or third cousins, but...
I'm a big fan of cousins.
Now, there was also another thing I wanted to ask. If there is time for it, there was a voice exercise that I wanted to do. using these books that I have.
See, I own four of of Jim Davis's U.S. Acres comics. And you've got Orson here, and I thought I'd do, like, either Tom Hoogie's. That's how you say his last name, right?
He says Hoogie.
Hoogie, okay.
Yeah.
I used to think it was huge, but then again...
Well, that's how it's spelled.
and then, like, Howard Morris, depending on the comic.
All great friends, including Jim Davis, and I've been a very pampered guest at their home in Muncie, Indiana, and their studios in Muncie, Indiana. And Jim Davis has a quote that I love, which is, he says, "The world is only really funny from Muncie, Indiana." Once you get to Washington, D.C., and Hollywood, and New York, and wherever... It's not as funny, but from the middle of the country, everything looks hilarious.
I think that applies to our hometown, too.
Of course it does. And when I'm when I do auditions, I'm from the middle of the middle, which is a great place from which to move left, right, up, and down.
And now, Gregg Berger's range in one clip.
Smile, Mr. Seymour Chomsky of Pork Chop Haven, North Dakota. You're on Candid Skunk. Thank you. I love you. You were a great audience. Another day, another souffle. Hope to see you all tomorrow. Bye-bye till then.
That's a wrap, Mr. McScam.
Glad that's over. Good. Because I have a couple of things to ask you. Get lost, bub. No interviews on taping days. Oh, shut up, you miserable...
Too bad Skunky's coming back.
What did you say?
When?
You and I are going to have a little heart-to-heart talk. Push broom. Oh, Chomsky.
Huh?
If you want to keep your meal ticket, we're going to have to finish what we started. Skunky is not going to come back and kick my cooking show out of his time slot. Come, Seymour. We have a birthday party to attend.
I'm enjoying it.
You have no idea how humbling this is for me. I've been a fan of yours since Orson Pig.
Thanks. I appreciate it, and he's a personal favorite. They're all personal favorites.
Yeah.
I've got so many characters that are tied for first place that the only question that's impossible to answer is which is my favorite. They're all my favorite for different reasons. in truth, they were jobs until they became more than jobs, and if you were fortunate enough to be entrusted with a character through the arc of a series, you know, it gets to be family. They're your family as much as your family is your family.
Before I start the questions, I want to officially offer my hands in friendship to you, Gregg Berger.
How's it going?
If ambrosia is a liquid, it's all around me right now is vapor. So I'm going to start out with question one, and I'm pretty sure that you're going to expect this. What high school did you go to?
University City High. And last year, I guess it was, it was the year before pandemic. I forgot we all lost a year, but I was inducted into the University City High School Hall of Fame alongside Tennessee Williams and many, many luminaries in all fields, including medicine, science, entertainment, literature, you name it. And I don't know if anyone a block from the ceremony knew that it was happening, but it meant the world to me. I'm all about bringing pride back to the hometown. And I was on a float the next day in the homecoming parade. They had me in a convertible Corvette. And, geez, I felt very, very much proud and humbled at the same time. But I had a blast, and high school was a highlight for me. You know, I tried to make every day of that experience be everything it could be. I didn't slough off school at all, but I also was very involved in activities and things. And I always see St. Louis as sort of an Archie and Veronica growing up place. I'm not, some days I was Archie, some days I was Jughead. I never had enough money to be Reggie, but you know, I loved the experience of growing up in the Midwest. It's my anchor. It's why I still think I'm kind of one of the people that people lean on for advice or just hang out with. Nothing but fun. I think it's not a really what you're great showing, but, way to grow up. Very
I don't know if you're going to be able to see it. It's a Lucite thing that my dad got me the last time we went to the Arch.
Yeah, beautiful.
Yeah.
I love that.
Unfortunately, the Eagleton building that they erected here makes it so you can't see the Capitol directly anymore.
I see it now. Man, I know about the Dred Scott courthouse steps. I love my town. I love my hometown.
I love it all the more for finding out that you've been a part of it.
You know, I still flirt with the idea of ending up there someday. I still have work to do here, and I still have family and friends and life here. Mm-hmm. But I love every opportunity to visit.
Well, I hope you
now,
visit.
Now, sometimes it's celebrations and sometimes it's funerals, but I do get back. And sometimes it's being inducted into the Hall of Fame. In the same year, I was inducted into the Transformers Hall of Fame. Actually, that was last year because it was virtual through something Hasbro calls PulseCon.
Mm-hmm.
And that's some nice company, too, including Steven Spielberg and Michael Bay and
Susan Blue.
Frank Welker and Peter Cullen, and it's a very select and wonderful group. And again, I'm proud and humbled to be inducted into it. These are the things that bring great pride.
Well, you're probably not going to recognize the character that I have in my hand. It's a different design, but it's Grimlock. And it's very sentimental because you've been in Grimlock for as long as I can remember. And one of my earliest memories was watching SOS Dinobots on VHS with my brother.
Most original issue Grimlock toys have a broken neck because young people try too hard to adjust them and transform them.
I remember that when I tried to get the Generation 2 blue one. I've had a couple of Grimlock toys, but I'm waiting to get the Studio Series one that just came out.
It's beautiful.
The one that came with Wheelie.
Yeah. Thankfully, G1, Grimlock, Long Haul, Skyfire, and Outback have taken me most of the way around the world through invitations to comic conventions where people bring their original toys a lot of times, and their kids, and sometimes their grandkids, and I have a signing table and do panels. But that whole convention experience has given me a whole new love of fandom, which I always had anyway. But, I really love that platform, plus the travel opportunities are very, very nice.
While we're on the subject of G1 Transformers, Outback, how does it make you feel that you and Dan Gilveson shared that role?
You know, I don't know who did it first. I know certain vowel sounds create that Outback sound,
mm-hmm.
And he was always off to the Outback. But Dan told me that we had both voiced the role. I didn't know that. And I don't know origin-wise or Wikipedia-wise who did it first, who did it longest, or I didn't know that we had both done it.
You know, actually, I think I can shed a little light on that. See, this VHS right here, Five Faces of Darkness, it's one of the gems of my collection. It takes place immediately after Transformers the movie.
Right.
Gilveson was out back alongside Buster Jones's blaster, while you and Dick Gauthier were both on Planet Char spying on the Decepticons after Spike, Ultra Magnus, and Cup were kidnapped.
Sorry for the Decepticons. Me, Grimlock, not feel sorry. Me, Grimlock, laugh! Autobots! Me, Grimlock, not afraid of Decepticons! Destroy them!
Rodimus, me, Grimlock, demand you wake up.
And so it was when Buster Jones and Dan Gilveson were in the episode, they were in that stupid country called Carbamia. And that is a major clod in the churn for me when it comes to this VHS.
Forever for that. Because it cost us Casey Kasem.
Uh-huh. There you go.
I hate Abdul Fakadi. I hate that episode Thief in the Night.
were you in that episode as Grimlock? Because he had Dino DNA, and so did Trypticon. I hope
if
to God.
If Dino DNA was involved, I was probably present.
Yeah, and Maurice LaMarche was also in that episode as Six Gun, and part of Metroplex.
Some great company, and because Wally was so careful in the casting, I maintain that's the reason that it launched so many, not only jobs, not only ongoing characters, but also careers. And all of the people you just named, I've been friends with for a lifetime. We continue to see each other in studio. May Dick Godio rest in peace. But we still see each other. Everybody's still part of it. Everybody is still active. And if you feed and water it properly and take care of it and respect it, the voice is one of the faculties that can last you the longest. When I did the new Jetsons, Dawes Butler was in the room, June Foray was in the room, Janet Waldo was in the room. I was seated next to Mel Blanc, George O'Hanlon was on the phone. But, I mean, they were all at the other side of their lifetimes. Not lifetimes, but they were senior, but you know...
Carly Quasar, we're in the same cosmic literature class.
Really? Do you know Space Cars, Burley? Mine is dead.
I'll check it out. And the name is Curly.
I played Curly Quasar, and I had a blind date with Judy Jetson, and boy, oh boy, Judy Jetson was Judy Jetson from the beginning to the end. Tiffany notwithstanding.
I brought that up with Michael Bell, and yeah. I told him that they made a big mistake.
The impression I got was that, you know, he didn't mind it as much, and I have to agree on a certain point where every voice actor deserves to have their chance, and Tiffany included.
Because if given half a chance, I would want to do Bugs Bunny, you know, the way Jeff Boydman was able to.
That's very good. Thanks. Very, very good.
They could also do a good Bill Scott, too.
Excellent. You know?
I don't pay lip service to the voiceover industry, Gregg. I've been a fan of your guys' ever since before I knew about the voice actors that were in this book, and I hate the fact that you and Bell aren't in it.
You go where you're invited. Over the course of a lifetime, it works out. But Animation Magazine named me one of their 10 best of the new generation, and that was the new generation in the early 2000s. Mm-hmm. But what I like is that so many of us get confused with classic voices and contemporary voices because, you know, the goal is to keep it current. And so many of these franchises, thank heaven, have kept me busy for decades, literally decades, and the Garfield show continues to grow a new audience every 2 to 4 years. Somebody's going into that, like, sweet spot age range, and they discover it as their new favorite show.
Hello, folks, how do you do? Garfield here to entertain you.
The cat's out of the bag. Everybody's favorite feline has made his video debut.
I don't believe it.
Well, believe it.
There's people who've seen other generations of Transformers and find their way to G1 and care about the characters and the story, and the technical aspects may not be as advanced, but the stories are so good and the characters are so well drawn, and you're allowed to care about the characters. There you have it.
Plus, I also have the four other DVDs that have the primetime specials on them. I think there's three of each on each of them.
You, beautiful. Julie Payne, Lorenzo Music, Tom, and so many others. I mean, that was my childhood defined. I was born in 86, so I'm as old as Transformers, perfect. The movie.
Wade, you're afraid of everything made. I've never seen anything like it. You're afraid of the water, afraid of the dark, afraid of the nighttime too, the sun and the shade. I'm really afraid. Wade, what'll we do with you?
I know, I'm kind of a panophobe.
I'm afraid, you know.
I can't even blink because I'm afraid of the dark.
Oh, hey, while it's fresh in my mind, I wanted to share with you my Frank Welker along with my Howie Morris. Let me know what you think.
Cajun food. Hey, like, you ever had blackened eggplant, man?
Oh, everything I cook comes out blackened, including the angle food cake.
He has to wear an inner tube in case he has a water landing.
Oh, and I love the thing about his inner tube, that it follows his facial movements and expressions everywhere.
Yep, never commented on, but there it is. It's always there.
And there was also later on in the series, there was an episode where you were reading Rumpelstiltskin to Frank Welker, and Frank Welker shelled, and Howie Morris.
Yeah, we can't sleep, Orson. Read us a story. Yeah, your stories can put anyone to sleep.
I'll ignore that.
His character, Wade, he's wearing Grimmy slippers from Mother Goose and Grimm.
Because I think Paws and United had Mother Goose and Grimm. Which,
Mother
by the way...
Goose and Grimm. They did.
And Charlotte Peters, St. Louis mainstay, her son, Mike, was the guy who created Mother Goose and Grimm. I don't need to remind you that. I'm just telling our audience.
I worked with Mike more than once, more than twice, more than 10 times, all through. But we met through United Media Mendelsohn and Garfield and San Diego Comic-Con. Occasionally he did a panel which preceded the cartoon voice panel called, what did they call it? It essentially was a cartoonist whose line is it anyway. It was an improv cartooning panel. Quick Draw. And both of those panels were midday Saturday, and two of the favorite panels of the entire convention. So, and both of them had overflow rooms of 3,000 plus people. There are times, including that panel, where I begin to realize that. It's never that I don't realize it, but it reminds me that it matters to the people that it matters to, and that there are people who know more about what I've done than I know about what I've done. And, you know, it's like an ego bath every time, but at the same time, it just makes me drop my jaw in wonder that things can have such a far reach. It's really quite a beautiful thing.
Talking about that reminds me of... two points that I talked about with Michael Bell a couple of weeks ago. I'd like to call him Swoop, actually.
He answers to Swoop. I didn't know if you were going to clarify that.
So two things that I brought up was, two things that we talked about were, voice acting is one of the best mediums out there, because the people who are actually dedicated to it, like you and Michael and Peter Cullen, Frank Welker, Jim Cummings, Tara Strong, all the others, is because it doesn't feed the ego as much as, like, when he was on a soap opera and when you were in Inside Out.
Inside Out, Police Academy, I've got an entire on-camera career, I've got an entire on-stage career. There's a beautiful anonymity about voiceover, which has no limits. You can be any species, any gender, if you play it right. There are no limits. You can go wherever your voice takes you. But your voice takes you where the acting takes you. It's voice acting with the emphasis on the acting. Mm-hmm. If you haven't got your chops, and if you don't know how to find the third dimension of a character, it doesn't matter how interesting your voice is. If you bring truth to the character, the voice will always follow, always be consistent, and always ring true. That's the skill set that's required, which involves acting training and improvisational training, and it's the only way to stay spontaneous in the moment. And then the rest is bringing the truth to whatever story you're tasked with telling. Whether if it's funny, it gets funnier. If it's epic, it gets more epic. If it's galactic battle, it gets more all the marbles. That's what makes things contagiously interesting. That's what engages an audience. That's what I believe, and that's what I teach.
I wholeheartedly agree with that. The other thing that Michael and I spoke about, and I don't think he necessarily agreed with this.
I agree with this, but me looking at my voiceover heroes from the outside, I've always imagined going back in time and being a part of the action, being side by side with my voiceover heroes. And maybe it wasn't that way back then. It was in the 80s and such. It was just a job. As we enter where we are now, Do you feel a sense of, like, brotherhood between your fellow voice actors and voice actresses?
Beyond brotherhood, I've gone, sadly, to so many memorial services for people we've lost along the way, that's when it really sunk in for me, mm-hmm. that I've spent as much time with some of the people in that side of my family as I spend with my family. And I spent a lot of time with my family. But you realize you spend days, weeks, months, years together, and I'm a team player. So if I'm in a series with somebody, I want to, you know, extend that hand of friendship and bonding and just make it as pleasant an experience as it can be for everybody. But along the way, you get to know each other. You know, the original Transformers and G.I. Joe sessions were so long, and they did a lot of writing during the session, rewriting, modifying, amending, and all the times that was happening, we'd be in the parking lot or in the green room, but we'd be hanging out, you know, and getting acquainted. And if Scatman brought his ukulele, nobody wanted to go back to work.
Attention, Cobra! Evacuate Red Rocket Drive-In with new haste! We will commence firing in 5 seconds! 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, fire! Wail to Joe Face! Mission accomplished with gusto! Good work!
The jokes are great. You know, it tends to be a well-read group of people because basically we're readers. We're interpreting the writer's concept and the artist's concept and trying to honor and collaborate with all of those other elements. So, you know, in on camera, where I spend a lot of my career as well, it tends to be a room full of distinctive-looking people all seeking to get the job, but essentially, because you're in a category on camera, there's some similarity between all the people in the room. The similarity between all the people in the room for voiceover is just that they love doing it, they're good at it, they've done their homework, they've risen through the ranks, and they've brought something to the table that didn't exist at the table before. You know, not that it's not wonderful to be able to sound like people who already exist. Mm-hmm. It's fantastic.
Mr. and Mrs. Bronson, if I might take a moment of your valuable time.
Valuable's what it is, man. You take care of the customers. I'll take care of this stiff.
We're not selling, and you're not buying. Do I make myself clear? For this.
And that can be very lucrative in the field of looping and dubbing. Yeah. But it always comes down to the breakthrough is always something that doesn't already exist. 'Cause most of those people are still active and still viable and still trustable as what they already do. But it's a fabulous skill. I owe a lot of my longevity to being a lousy impressionist. So the things I do come out sounding as something new and different. That's kind of a curse and a blessing.
So it sounds like you and I have opposite problems. I mean, I could do at least 113 different existing voices. But the problem is, I have Asperger's syndrome, and you know, in high school, that's where you develop the most, and I was a major cartoon buff. So I can do probably an entire episode of The Simpsons on my own.
Not a deaf homer. It's Friday night, Mo. I want to try something special. Okay, here you go. Doof from Sweden.
But I really don't have a voice of my own, not that I could find, and that's why I'm not in the professional field and why I'm becoming a court reporter. So my niche right now is I'm trying to make myself a presence in the voiceover field in my own way by doing my Nevertomes videos that are on my channel, and I've created
That's great.
I've created a mythos series of stories that are, if you can believe this, a cross between Peter Pan and Dick Tracy, even though the precedent is already set with Charlie Corsmo and
Dustin. In another world, liberated by a mysterious miniature human female with fairy wings and a literal head of flame, their chance meeting would ignite a love that was believed to have been fated.
Tragically, both the man and the fairy female would die that same day that they met. There are those that believe that their bond has survived beyond the grave, paving to their rebirth almost 150 years later. Three poignant stories of kidnapping, lost loves, and war. A true testament to the unpredictable and unforgiving torrents of fate. Join me. You may be able to reignite your faith in the unexplained.
Blue Interior!